Welcome back to another Road to Hollywood. We're so glad you could join us tonight. It's great to be back. Got all sorts of stories. We've got a very special guest in the studio and lots of knowledge to drop on you. So get out your pens and pads. It's going to be an exciting show. Without further ado, I want to introduce our guest tonight. He is the CEO of a red-hot independent label making major moves out there in the new music industry. He is the CEO of Funk Volume Records, and this is Dame Ritter. Welcome to the Road to Hollywood.
Thanks for having me, Jay. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much for joining us. Again, you've all seen the XXL freshman and how illustrious it is to be among these, you know, top 12 guys here. You know, former members include Kendrick Lamar and J. Cole and so many of the heavyweights. Well, last year, his artist Hopsin and his partner made it on the freshman, is doing major things on the underground. And this year, DIZZY WRIGHT, his second release, he's 2 for 2. That's Hopsin, DIZZY WRIGHT, this is Funk Volume. And Dame, first of all, I want to congratulate you on that success.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Please, give us a little bit of background. I know you're from L.A. You went to school up in Berkeley and Stanford, got that MBA. You know, what made you pursue, you know, the music business coming out of a great school like that?
Well, I didn't necessarily pursue it coming right out of Stanford. I was actually in the corporate world doing management consulting, and it just so happened I got laid off about a year into it. And at that time, I wasn't trying to go back into consulting because I didn't like the experience. But it just so happened that Hopsin was actually signed to Ruthless Records at the time. Sure. But they weren't doing anything with his project, so he was kind of needed some help kind of getting out there. You know, he just wanted to do it himself, trying to get his music some exposure. He knew my younger brother, who's Swizz. Swizz at the time was going to UC Irvine. In a similar situation, in the sense that he wanted to do music and just needed some help kind of getting it out there. He wasn't really passionate about school. He didn't really find his passion in school, so he wanted to drop out of school and pursue music. So I teamed up with those guys and initially just kind of helped him out, you know, put up a website, give him some direction in the social networking. You know, we released a mixtape. And it just kind of grew from there, just kind of slowly building and you know, putting out visuals, eventually touring, more visuals, more tours. You know, eventually Hopsin got a collab with Tech N9NE, which helped him as well. So it's just a continuous process of building on small wins, and that's kind of created the momentum that we have now.
Well, it's really exciting. Obviously, here with Indie Power and the IES, you know, Indie Entertainment Summit team, you know, we're all behind, you know, the independent opportunities that are out there today. I'm 40 years in the business, so I came up in the old school, came up through the regular record companies where you had to get a record deal to try and get to the record stores or radio or MTV or BET and all that. And now those guys aren't playing music videos. There's not too many record stores out there anymore. Right. And you've got so many other forms of exposure other than that corporate radio. You know, so it's real exciting to hear the path. Like I told you previous, you know, I was aware of Hopsin, you know, for years, and some associates of mine were handling him, and I know about the whole Ruthless situation with Tamika and everything. And you know, I know it's a frustrating situation when, you know, a label signs you, you think they have a plan, but there's a whole lot of waiting around and right. Not much going on. And what's exciting to see is what you guys have done pretty much, like I say, outside, you know, the music business, so to speak, you know, through the music videos you make, the touring you do with a lot of these independent companies like Guerrilla Union and things like that. You're kind of flying under the radar and dealing directly with the public, right. Which is exciting. You know, that was always something that we, you know, aspired to, you know, in the past. So take us inside the, you know, the mind of Hopsin here and, you know, finally getting free from Ruthless. Did he have a plan? Did you guys formulate a plan? Or was it, let's just start dropping mixtapes and videos and make it up as we go?
Right. Well, I mean, it was kind of a plan. I mean, we just, from the outside looking in, you know, at the music industry, we just looked at our fans as essentially like the bloodline of your career. As you grow your fan base, you know, anything that you want to do within music, you'll be able to do if you have enough fans. So if you want to tour, you got enough fans to do it, then, you know, promoters will book you and you can tour. If you want sponsorship dollars, you know, if you have enough fans, enough eyeballs coming to your website, coming to your shows, you'll be able to do that. So, you know, we just looked at the situation. It was like, look, we're going to go direct to fans with our music through our social networks, through YouTube, and start building our fan base. And eventually, if we get enough people, if we get enough numbers, you know, people will start checking for us, and we can start building the relationships, you know, and then eventually bring on more artists and just continue to build. So yeah, it's really just about our fans, why we appreciate our fans so much. Everything we do, we try to interact with our fans, give back to our fans, you know, meet and greets at shows, contests on our website, in our social networks, you know, because we understand how important our fan base is.
Yeah, well, obviously you guys can follow the lead of someone like a Tech N9NE, somebody who's very, very active, you know, with the fan base and
right.
and all that. But, you know, I know that collaboration obviously opened your artists up to Tech's audience and all that. Who were some of the other mentors and people you learned from or were inspired by, or some of those early tours that really opened some doors for you?
I mean, we definitely looked to build with Strange and kind of see, you know, what they were doing. But to be honest, we just kind of grinded it out and learned on our own. You know, just doing the research. It's not rocket science once you, you know, putting together shows. It's a lot of work, you know, to do your own videos. For Hop does his own music. Originally, he was mixing, mastering his own show, I mean, his own songs. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot of work, but I can't necessarily say we turned to anybody because not too many people reached out to us and were willing to help until we got a fan base. So again, if you want help, you know, build fans.
Yeah. So, as far as those initial, you know, bricks in the wall that gave you some stability, walk us through that. Did the song go viral? Was there the something that kind of gave you the foothold?
No, I mean, it really was a continuous process of building those small wins. Like, if you look back, you know, we released Haywire. Haywire was a compilation, you know, album or mixtape between Hopsin and Swizz. You know, it did well. It got quite a few downloads on our website, probably in the tens of thousands eventually. You know, they released a couple visuals off that. Lucifer Effect, Bad Motherfucker. So we released that, and then we were just kind of grinding it out. And Hopsin was still in his deal at that time, so, you know, we were kind of waiting around to see what was going to happen with that. You know, and for that was just a waiting game because he had released an album under Ruthless, and they had a year to pick up the second option. So we just kind of waited to see if they were going to pick it up. They didn't. So as soon as they didn't pick it up, we released his first album under Funk Volume called Raw. And Raw did well. You know, we were able to build up enough of a buzz and a fan base to be able to do our first Raw tour. And that tour we did all ourselves. We booked it all ourselves. We, you know, interacted with the promoters. We just kind of went out there and did it. You know, we did about 40 cities, you know, there was five of us on the road. We were staying in like one room, yeah. You know, just grinding it out just to prove to people that our fan base just wasn't online. We can hit the road and tour. So as soon as we got off that tour, we had, you know, a few dates actually in Australia. Somebody had reached out and we did some shows in Australia. And then I think when we came back, Hopsin dropped Illmind of Hopsin 4, and that video did very well. It got, you know, a couple million views before the collab with Tech N9NE and B.O.B. But again, so once he got the collab with Tech N9NE and B.O.B., we got news that you know, he was on XXL cover. So everything just kind of built up. So if you look back, you know, of all the videos that he dropped a video called Kill Her, which did really well. Sag My Pants, which did really well. Swizz dropped a couple videos in a series called Good Morning Swizzle. They did very well. So it's just constantly building, you know, because once people like your page or follow you on Twitter, it's not really going anywhere. I mean, some people unlike your page or unfollow you, but, you know, you just continue to build, you know. And like I said, eventually people take notice.
So it's very much like individual bricks in the wall, you know. It takes a while to get that wall built, but
right.
Each brick is, you know, another level. So it sounds like it was kind of obviously frustrating, you know, being under the Ruthless deal, but you wanted to go out and prove you were somebody, but you didn't want to prove you were too hot or they would have picked up the option.
Well, I mean, I wasn't really allowed in the meeting, so I don't know what went on. You know, at that time, Hopsin had a few different managers. I think he had three managers. You know, there were a couple people at the label, and everybody was pulling in different directions. So when that happens, you just kind of stay in the same place. You know, I offered to help, you know, I put together a marketing plan. It didn't have funk volume on it. You know, I was just going to send it to him. This is what you need to do, because Hopsin's not like NWA. You know, he's a different type of artist. You know, his core fan base is a different demographic. So, you know, so I actually never met anybody at Ruthless, I think, for maybe one time. You know, so me personally, I didn't have any interaction with him. I just know how frustrated Hopsin was.
Yeah. But, I mean, you wanted to get out of the deal, but you wanted to move your career forward, but you kind of had to wait till you were free to let it go.
Right, yeah.
Because so, if it heated up too much during that, they would have picked up the option and then maybe belabored the point.
Yeah, well, they weren't going to let Hopsin release that album anyway, the Raw album. So, you know, yeah, but there was only so much we could do.
Yeah.
Being in that situation.
Well, it's real exciting to hear, you know, behind the scenes. Again, it's a whole new industry. And our guest tonight, he is Dame Ritter. He is the CEO of Funk Volume, one of the happening independent labels out there in the urban world. After this break, we're going to come back. We're going to talk about his new artist, Dizzy Wright, some of the exciting things going on with Rock the Bells. Of course, the new freshman cover and the whole XXL shows they're doing right now. Lots more coming up right here on the road to Hollywood. Coming right back is Indie Power.
This be the one them call Tech N9NE.
What's up, it's your boy Mac 10.
What up, y'all? This Crazy Bone from Bone Thugs.
What's up, this is B-Rail from Cypress Hill.
Hey, yo, this is Method Man.
It's your boy Warren G.
This is MC Light.
Yo, this is K-Solo for Indie Power, man. If it's inside of you, man, it's inside of the power, man.
DMX, and you better be checking out Indie Power, right?
What up, though? Indie Power.
One and only, IndiePower.com.
If you got any music out there and you're really trying to get in the game, make sure you check out Indie Power. They're going to make it happen for you.
So you see what this shirt says, right? It says Indie Power. Everybody that know anything about rap music and Tech N9NE, them, they know that Tech N9NE got Indie Power. I'm the number one independent artist in the country.
Totally independent, and I love it.
Everything's important about the indie world. It has been for a long time.
You got more control, and you make 10 times as much money. 10 times more money.
Because of the internet and because of the greed of those old school executives at these record companies, the power is now in your hands, artists.
Take back your art and don't sell yourself cheap or short to anyone.
Once you're independent, then you become interdependent, meaning you rely on yourself and then others wind up relying on you, and it's like the sun and the earth, everybody relying on each other, you know what I mean? Building it up, strong foundation. That's how Wu-Tang started, you do the same thing.
Don't wait for nobody, do your thing, man. You know, life is short, you only live once.
You gotta be a part of doing you first, and that means independence.
What's important is the business aspect of it, you know, because, like, man, you can never forget it's called the music business. You know what I'm saying? 90% is business, 10% is music. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, you have to look at it like that, because if you don't, you'll be broke.
Get up off your ass. Don't sit there, wait around for the man to hand you this, hand you that. Anybody to hand you anything. This is Indie Power, baby. Do your thing.
I don't have anybody telling me you shouldn't write that song, Tech. That's going to offend some people. We do this. We do our merchandise. We put our artists out when we wanna.
And that's why I chose to go the independent route, because you have more control, more say-so, more freedom to be an artist, you know, than dealing with a major, you know what I'm saying? I'm working with Indie Power right now, you know what I'm saying? Much love to them, you know what I'm saying? So y'all gonna start seeing a lot of the life entertainment, Crazy Bone, in your face all over worldwide. So, you know, y'all watch out for that, because it's going down. Indie Power representing the life entertainment.
You know you got the power. The power is in you. Make your music, do you. Don't let nobody tell you what you can or cannot do. Do you. Make your music. Enjoy what you do. Do it from the heart. Love what you do. Expand. Don't be afraid to create. Create. Be original. Make your music.
Do not wait on no majors. Go with Indie Power. That's what I did.
Keep your money, man. Your publishing, man. How you get paid, man? How you take care of your kids, man? How you put them through college, man?
Write it, rap it, produce it,
mix it, arrange it, wrap it, sell it. That gives you the power.
If your business is not moving forward, then you're moving backwards. You know what I'm saying? You need to have your business right, have it tight, in the game, and then you'll know how your business will be running if you're dealing with Indie Power. Indie Power have you in the game, you know what I'm saying?
When it comes to putting it out there and getting it out there and get that worldwide distribution, Indie Power is the way, Jack.
Indie Power, baby. Gotta move it to where you wanna move it.
You have the right to do your music the way you want to do it. You've got the power. Indie Power.
Yeah, Indie Power, man. Go ahead, man. Get it on yourself. Self-promotion is the best promotion. All right? It's about doing what you want to do, getting your music out there to the people, and not somebody dictating what the hell you doing. They want you to sound like Jay-Z. They want you to sound like Fabulous. They want you to sound like Ludacris. They want you to sound like Eminem. They want you to be a replica. No, that ain't how music elevates. Indie Power. It's hard to use your own money. Don't think it's easy, because your money can't compete with the majors. But if you believe in it, you will achieve it, and keep pushing. Keep pushing. Indie Power is the best you can do, baby.
All right, shout out to that Indie Power. You dig? We independent and standing strong in it. Be action.
Get with Indie Power.
You got the power. Indie Power.
Indie Power, man. You already know. Infamous.
Indie Power, you already know what it is.
Indie Power, man. Check it out.
IndiePower.com. Put the power in your hands, you dig?
That's how we do it, you feel me?
That's it. The power is within you. It's Indie Power. That's what we're talking about tonight. We're talking about artists that are doing this outside the mainstream, without the support of big radio or big media, really going out there and in your own creative team, making the moves happen that eventually are packing these halls and clubs, getting you on these tours and festivals, and taking this internationally. Our guest tonight, he is Dame Ritter. He's the CEO of Funk Volume. Their artist Hopsin is doing big things out there. And now, Dame, tell us about Dizzy Wright and kind of the strategy. How did you know when it was time, you know, to come out with Dizzy? What was kind of the setup that you did to lay the groundwork for him?
I guess we had all, I mean, we always knew we wanted to grow. I mean, you know, we never wanted the label to just be Hopsin and Swizz. So we're always online, you know, people are always posting their music on our pages. And we just came across his video. I believe his first video that we saw was a video called Somebody or Nobody. And it was just real cool. The lyrics were real cool. You know, but I think for us, like, we always look for something different than what we already have, you know. So he was definitely different from Hopsin and Swizz. So I just kept following him online, you know, because I didn't reach out right away. I just kind of like to see how people move by themselves, you know, because I feel like people that move by themselves will have a better understanding of what we do. You know, so I watched him, and it just so happened that I was attending a local competition in L.A. supporting a friend of mine who was competing. It was actually a competition that had a hip-hop portion and an R&B portion. My friend was actually in the R&B portion, but when I went there, well, my friend had won, so he went to the finals. So I guess there were satellite competitions in a bunch of different cities. So when I went back and supported the final round, Dizzy was there because he was representing Vegas for the hip hop portion. And then when I saw his live show, it just complimented everything else he was doing. I saw that he captured everybody's attention. And then I reached out to him right after that, just introduced myself, followed up and reached out to his manager at the time. And then came out to another show, and eventually we invited him out to meet us and kind of see what, so we can show him what we do. And he went with us to Denver. So, you know, you can tell people, you know, because a lot of people don't know what you do until you see one of our shows and you see a lot of people come out and the energy that's out there. So he saw it. He saw that it was real. You know, eventually came on board, and he hasn't stopped moving. You know, he's doing very well.
Well, it's exciting, you know, rather than the old-fashioned, you know, we're going to sign you and then try and develop you. You know, these days it sounds like you can kind of organically, you know, grow the relationship, kind of to test the characteristics of the qualities, you know, of the artist to see if you guys are compatible, if you get along on the road.
Right.
If, like you say, if he's a self-starter, he's not going to be so, you know, dependent or, you know, reliant on you guys for everything. You know, it's always good if you have all these, you know, troops that are moving forward on their own, but collectively there's a, you know, there's an energy or a synergy, you know, between them.
Right.
You know, so that's exciting these days. What are some of the other things you're doing to kind of check out new talent? What does your radar look like? You know, obviously that's how Dizzy came on board. Obviously you get, you know, submissions or
right.
things like that. What, you know, what's the process like?
I mean, most of the time it just starts online, you know, because we're online all the time mm-hmm. anyway, you know, and we just come across videos. People submit their videos to us, you know, but it can happen, and it happened the same way with Jaron Benton, a similar process, but, you know, we're at a lot of shows, you know, I'm at a lot of live shows, and you know, I feel like I have a good, I have a good sense of what's going on in the underground hip hop community. You know, cats that haven't really, you know, developed or blown up yet. So we're constantly looking for pieces that might fit, you know, what we do. So
your ears are always open, the radar is on, but right. you obviously are in no hurry. You can just kind of organically see what kind of fits the,
right,
the team
right.
and
yeah no hurry at all. I mean, because that's a very important decision, especially being such a small team. Mm-hmm. When you bring somebody on, like we have to be right every time. Like, we can't be wrong. You know, it takes you know, it takes a lot of time to bring an artist on, to takes money, mm-hmm. you know, so the chemistry has to be right. So we take a lot of time to look how that artist moves. He's around us, you know, probably do some shows with us, you know, because the chemistry has to be right. I mean, the music has to be dope. The live show has to be dope. You have to get along. You kind of have to understand how we move, because there's not going to be a huge advance, you know, where everything's just, you know, everything's just easy. You're not going to be traveling in a bus right away. You know, you're probably carrying your own luggage. It's going to be an independent grind, you know, even if you sign to us. But, you know, as Dizzy has seen, he's constantly seeing things get better and better. You know, where he might have been four people to a room originally, now he's got his own room. You know, he's doing well. He's supporting his family, everything that he should be doing as a young man.
Well, that's exciting. Like I say, it's an evolution, having been involved in the industry for years. And, you know, there was only one way to do it, so to speak. You know, back in the major label days, they really tried to control it. And even though the independents existed, you know, for years, it was, you know, they kind of tried to control, you know, radio
right, right.
outside of college. And, of course, they certainly jumped in and tried to control MTV and BET and, of course, retail and all that. Now, I know you guys have been strictly digital.
Right.
And what is your plan, or where are the demands for physical product as far as you see in the marketplace?
It's there. You know, we're working on a distribution deal now. You know, we're just trying to figure out what makes it the most sense for us. So for Hopsin's album, we definitely have our physical distribution in place. Mm-hmm. People still buy records or CDs. Actually, more people are buying records too. Vinyl seems to be coming back as well.
Yeah.
You know, we'll hopefully have that sorted out within the next couple months, so that you can start getting Funk Volume albums in stores as well.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Now, you say you got some offers and you ran over to Australia. Have you been cultivating any of the other foreign markets so far?
Sure. I mean, Australia is a big market for hop. You know, and Funk Volume as a whole. Actually, Dizzy and Jaron are going back to Australia at the end of July. You know, Europe is a good market for us. We actually have a PR firm that helps us in Germany. You know, so as we do better, you know, we start to invest, and that's part of the independent grind too, is understanding where to invest and allocate your resources, because you probably don't have a lot of them. So you just got to figure out what works for you, you know, where you get the biggest bang for your buck. So we're definitely, you know, investing overseas, to try and increase our presence, you know, because there's a lot of loyal fans all over the world. You know, yeah. The U.S. is a great market. It's a big market, but, you know, there's a lot of opportunity overseas.
Well, that's always great, you know, as an independent, because you can. We always say fans are fans, sales are sales, you know, and where the majors are so hard to turn on a dime, and they, you know, they're so kind of bullheaded, you can pretty much, like you say, get on a plane, go over there and start building in Germany, which can lead to France or England or certainly, you know, all the other territories around that. And same thing with Australia or New Zealand or certainly Canada and stuff. And it's exciting to be able to kind of chart your own course and kind of follow where the fans are. You know, online if there's enough pocket, if there's a promoter that'll get out there and, you know, spread the word that, you know, it makes sense. Obviously, they're investing and bringing the act over. You're, you know, hoping to not only see a profit, but to grow, you know, that market. You know, we've seen it with so many acts over the years where you got these little pockets, you know, around the world, and all together, you know, it makes a great, you know, revenue stream or an opportunity for everybody to make a living, do this full time, and, you know, grow on that, you know. Obviously, you see it with Strange Music. You know, they must have 12 artists or something on their label now. And, you know, some of the other companies, you know, we're friends with the guys at, you know, RBC, and, you know, they do their label management thing and all that. So we're seeing pockets of not only the guys that came from the old school, you know, major label systems, you know, doing this independent, but, you know, the new breed. And, you know, it's so exciting having, like I say, heard about Hopsin for years and, you know, his frustrations in the, you know, the Ruthless deal that just never really blossomed, to see the you guys, you know, kind of create your own course, you know, because what we're seeing right now, whether it be Macklemore or Mac Miller or Tech N9NE or so many of these guys, they may have learned something from somebody else, but they're creating their own path. And it's exciting that, you know, for a first time in a while, there's really no rules. As long as it makes sense to the promoter or the store or the distributor and the artist, anything's possible. You know, I know you guys certainly aren't dependent on radio play, but, you know, it's pretty admirable, you know, that with Macklemore, you know, the first two singles have gone number one, and that's unheard of. Without a record deal, and he, you know, no artist even with a record deal has ever done that. So it's exciting to celebrate these, you know, successes, even though every artist stands on their own, you know. And, you know, we're super excited about what Funk Volume's doing, and we're going to be out there, you know, this summer supporting all the shows and spreading the word and really seeing you guys blossom. You know, we're going to be coming back here in a few minutes. Our guest tonight is Dame Ritter. He is the CEO. He's one of the architects of the great Funk Volume success story, and that is Hopsin, that is Dizzy Wright, Swizz, so much more coming from these guys. They're only getting started. When we get back, we're going to be talking about the big summer festivals. Of course, we've got Rock the Bells coming up. We're going to be talking about how they're translating this independent success to some of the biggest stages out there and taking it worldwide. Coming back right after this with more on the Road to Hollywood.
Hey, what up? This is Corey from Slipknot.
This is Matt Sorum from Velvet Revolver.
What's up? It's your boy Mac 10.
Hey, this is Mike Ines from Alice in Chains.
What's up? This is B Real from Cypress Hill.
What's up? I'm Sean from Yellow Card.
It's your boy Warren G.
I'm Brooks Wackerman from Bad Religion.
Hey, yo, this is Method Man.
This is Mick Jones from Foreigner.
I got a question for you. Are you serious about moving your creative career forward? Then you need to be at IES.
If you're a musician out there, you got a band, you want to rock, don't sit down on your ass and wait for someone to knock on your door.
You can do it yourself. Don't wait for nobody. Do your thing, man. You know, life is short. You only live once.
Totally independent, and I love it.
Everything's important about the indie world. It has been for a long time.
You got more control, and you make 10 times as much money. 10 times more money.
Don't wait for the record label, do it yourself.
People need to hear the music that's in your head, that's in your fingers, that's in your heart. So get out there and let's hear it.
Because of the internet and because of the greed of those old
old school executives at these record companies. The power is now in your hands, artists.
Take back your art and don't sell yourself cheap or short to anyone.
If you believe in your music, if you believe in your gift, if you believe what God has given you, make sure you go to IES, show the world what you got. It's going to be going down here in Los Angeles, and it's something that gets all you independent artists getting going on that drive, doing what you guys got to do, man.
Be independent. Don't be afraid to be independent.
You got to be a part of doing you first, and that means independence. I implore you to go to the IES, the Independent Entertainment Summit, and do your thing.
If you think you know what you're doing in this music business, I don't care who you are, there are things you will learn.
The indie way is the way, you know. The large corporations have basically disintegrated. They're looking to the indie community to create the music and create the genesis of what's going to be the next environment.
If you started a new band and you're having a little bit of trouble figuring out where to go next, or what you should be doing, who you should be talking to, whether you need a record label or how to get your music distributed, you need to go to the Indie Entertainment Summit. That's the place where you go to meet industry panel experts. They're going to tell you everything you need to know to get you where you want to be.
For me, I spend all of my days and months going around the world educating musicians on how they can better actually release their music and market their music. It's part of my mission, it's part of the way that we can grow the music business. So I'm going to go at all the important summits that I can go to, and the Indie Entertainment Summit is going to be one of the places that I'll be. You want to be educated? You want me to help educate it? You better be there.
If you rap, sing, dance, model, DJ, or act, or like myself, do comedy, you can't afford to miss this conference.
You're trying to do your thing in this business, and you're tired of waiting on somebody to help you. In August, come to LA, the Indie Entertainment Summit.
You know what time it is, man. It's that time, Rolex time. Chasing cash, get money, take care. Shout out to Hit Boy, G-Rock, Money Making Mad, Stacey B, and Sir Cuff. And we here with the Indie Entertainment Summit, man. Y'all need to be here, man. It's in LA in August, man. Beautiful people here, man, dropping knowledge, dropping gems about this new way to pursue this music and a new way to get this money, man.
It's the Indie Entertainment Summit. That's the IES, baby.
Very important place to be if you want information to take things to the next level. You may not have access to the internet. It's okay, too. Go there. You have an opportunity, IES.
Write it, rap it, produce it, mix it, arrange it, wrap it, sell it. That gives you the power.
Every second that you're sitting on your butt waiting for something good to happen, your competition is passing you by. So if you got a dream, go and fight for it and support Indie Entertainment Summit.
I need y'all to come out to my city and represent with the Entertainment Indie Summit. It's going down August 1st through the 5th. If you're an independent artist, you're an independent label, you want to get your music out there, you want to network, come out to Los Angeles.
You gotta do is if you wanna blow up in this industry, go to IES Conference in LA, Google it, you gotta be there.
Showcases, panels, opportunities, everything that Indie Entertainment Summit does is something that is very much for today's music industry. We know how it used to be, but we don't know how it's gonna be tomorrow. But I think the Indie Entertainment Summit is gonna be an opportunity for motivated, ambitious professionals to meet each other.
Music business is a hard thing to break into.
So you gotta do what you can. Check out IES, Indie Entertainment Summit.
If you're gonna be anywhere, you need to be at IES, man, in LA, man. That's where it's gonna be at.
It's going down just like that, August 1st through the 5th. IES, man.
If you ain't going to IES, you ain't gonna live to be an artist. You know why? IES, feed your mind, feed your soul. Get a good lawyer. They'll teach you which way to go.
If you're serious about your music, where do they need to be?
You gotta be at IES, yo.
What's that?
Indie Entertainment Summit.
You should check it out at IES.com. Hopefully this will become an annual event that we'll all be going to many years from now.
You need to be out to IES. That's IES, baby.
Going down. August 1st through the 5th.
You have to check out IES.
IES, show the world what you got.
Ain't no excuses. It's now or never.
It's your chance to show the world what you got.
IES.
I hope I see you there.
Indie Entertainment Summit, man. Circa, we gonna be there.
Indie motherfucking Entertainment Summit. Be there, Jay.
IES. Look for it online. The Indie Entertainment Summit.
If you really think you got what it takes to stand out, you really want to make sure you stand out, you can show the world what you got at the IES, the Indie Entertainment Summit.
IES. It's going to be here in Los Angeles.
Entertainment capital of the world. If you ain't there, you're nowhere.
We're back on the road to Hollywood. More information on the big IES event coming right up. Again, our guest tonight is Dame Ritter. He is the CEO. He's one of the architects, along with Hopsin, of the Great Funk Volume label. They are making big moves. Dizzy Wright is out there doing it big now. On literally, this is the cover on the newsstands right now. This is the freshman cover, Double XL. Of course, if you turn to this page right here, you'll see the big ad for IES. So we got a lot going on tonight. We're talking about basically making moves in the new music industry. Now, this is without the MTVs. This is without the, you know, the big-time radios, without the big-time retail stores. Not discounting any of those, just like Tech N9NE. It'll take some airplay if it comes, but you're not necessarily dependent on that. Dame, talk about that a little bit. You know, obviously, online is so much of your strategy. What is your strategy when it comes to radio as far as, like, online or college radio?
Right. Well, you know, this year that's one of the things we want to try to take a shot at is we will take a shot at radio. We feel like we're ready for it. We feel like the music's ready. We've saved up to invest in it. So this year, you know, we will be taking some shots at radio. So hopefully that's kind of the next step for us, and it'll give us a lot more exposure.
That's great. And are there any other things besides online and that potential radio? What are some of the other things you guys do offline to you know, get the word out into the streets or the communities? Any other things anywhere that you're using to create the buzz?
No, primarily what we've done has been online. You know, YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, now Instagram, and maybe even Vine seems to be a new social network that the guys really like. You know, wherever the people are, that's kind of where we are. So, you know, originally it was MySpace when we first started. You know, but then Facebook came on strong, and that's where everybody was at. So we paid a lot of attention to Facebook. You know, so wherever the people are online, that's where we'll be. But outside of being online, you know, we really haven't done we've done a lot of shows, so we connect with our fans at shows. You know, and the guys now have some exposure in XXL. But most of our stuff has been driven online. You know, this year we'll take a shot at radio, and we'll try to get our videos on MTV, MTV Jams, and stuff like that. But that's the next step for us.
Great. Now, how did the collaboration with Tech N9NE come about? Who reached out to who, and what, how'd that all come about?
I believe we were on the road. It might have been a Raw tour, and he just called. I believe I got the call. You know, I passed the phone to Hop, and he just talked to him and said he wanted him on his All Sixes and Sevens album, and he made it happen.
That's great. Well, it's an exciting thing to see, really, the development of this, because unlike those major label campaigns where it's like you throw it all against the wall at once, and, you know, if it sticks, great. If it doesn't, you're dropped. You're actually chipping away, you know, at the
right.
Rock, at the mountain, you know, piece by piece. And it seems like there's no, like, deadline. You know, well, I always say being independent, you can't put yourself on the shelf. Only you can tell you it's over, it's time to go to the next project. And that's
right.
Kind of exciting to see that you kind of developed this, you know, very organically. Now let's talk about some of the big shows. You know, we just saw, and we were at the big announcement for the Rock the Bells tour, which of course has become one of the biggest, you know, tours in hip hop today. They do Southern California, Northern California, D.C., and the New York, New Jersey area. And we saw, you know, the big announcement, of course, with the holograms, with ODB and Eazy-E, and of course Tech N9NE and people like that on the tour. But lo and behold, we're seeing both Hopsin and Dizzy Wright on that tour. Tell us kind of how all that came together. And I know you did pay dues. Talk about, you know, some of the special promoters like Guerrilla Union and some of the supporters that have really, you know, taken your artists to the bigger stages out there.
Right. So again, man, just going back to continuously building, you know, we've been doing our own shows for a long time, you know, and our show started with, you know, maybe 100 people there, maybe just 50 people there, maybe 400, 300, you know, 500, you know, and as our show started getting bigger, our online presence was getting bigger, you know, more people started reaching out, you know. So again, it just goes back to having fans. If you have fans, you know, if you got a lot of fans, then these promoters will want you on the show because your fans will go to the show. It's very simple. It's not rocket science. Again, like, sure. If you have fans, people will reach out to you to do the shows. And that's how it happens. You know, we just built a fan base to a point where people are checking for us now, and our fans like to come out and support. So, you know, promoters appreciate that.
I mean, we all work for the fans. They're the ones that pay the bills and make it all happen, you know. In this day and time, you see in so many acts, they're like, they're looking for a shortcut, you know. They're looking for the fake friends or the fake views or the, you know, how they can get on. They don't understand. The concert business, not about who you pay to get on that stage, but it's about, again, having fans in that market. The promoter wants you. The booking agent is getting, you know, dates. People are asking for the act or accepting the offers. You know, it all comes down to the real nitty-gritty. Even if you only have 1,000 fans, 5,000 fans, 10,000 fans, that's the beginning of something real. Right. You know, obviously, you know, online you can kind of check to see where the fans are and kind of gravitate towards them. But again, like you say, it's really no shortcut. If you don't have the fans, if people aren't willing to pay for the downloads, pay for the merch, pay for the tickets, what really do you have?
Right.
You know, start small.
It's a business. You know, it's a business. You know, these promoters aren't throwing shows because they love to throw shows. I mean, hopefully that's a part of it, you know, but to put on Rock the Bells, I'm sure it costs maybe hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Yes.
So how are you going to get that back? You got to put the acts on there that can attract the people that will pay for the tickets to get that money back and hopefully get a healthy return as well. So, you know, if you don't have fans, you know, it's very hard to get paid for a show. You know, there's not that many people that are just looking to put on a good show where if your show is good enough, you know, they'll take a shot and put you on the show. There's not that many shows out there like that. If you're not proven, you know, well, they'll still put you on.
Well, again, that's exactly it. It's a business. You know, a lot of people think it's like a talent contest. Like, well, why is that guy popular? I'm better than him. This guy has fans. You know, if you go find fans, you know, maybe the promoter or the booking agent, you know, wants you. And I know it's hard to get, you know, an agent these days. You guys obviously have an agent that's got an in to Chang and Guerrilla Union and all that. What was the process? Did the agent pursue you once you had a certain buzz, or did you guys go looking for the agent? How did that all go down?
Yeah, this interview is going to start getting real boring. I'm telling you, you just got to have fans. Like, the booking agents will come after you, and then, you know, if they see that you have a buzz, you know, booking agents typically get 10%. So they want the artists that are hottest, you know, because they'll get the highest offers, and they'll get paid more. So I hate to keep beating it to death, but that's if you have fans, like I said in the beginning, everything can materialize.
Right. If you got the bricks in the wall, you've got something to salute right there. Now, again, we're big fans of, you know, Chang and Guerrilla Union. Obviously, you know, without, you know, major backers, without some big corporation, even though they do shows in alliance with some of the big guys, what they've done independently, I mean, it's pretty amazing between Smoke Out and Paid Dues and, you know, with Rock the Bells, which is the one they take on the road. Were you guys fans of those shows, or, you know, were you aspiring or trying to move towards getting on their radar?
Yeah, I mean, I never had been to a prior Rock the Bells or Paid Dues or anything like that, but I've always heard of it. You know, I've always seen the lineup, you know, so that's definitely something that we wanted to be a part of. You know, it's so high profile. You know, a lot of dope acts come out, you know, a lot of more potential fans there. I mean, obviously, you know, our fans will show up, but it's such a diverse group of artists. You know, I'm sure you'll have a lot of people there to give us another opportunity to win over some fans and hopefully add to our fan base.
Now, do you have any special strategy? Because I know you guys just did pay dues. You got three stages going. You got 28,000 people, you know, milling about. Besides putting on a dope show, which is obviously the bottom line, and making sure your fans, you know about it and are in attendance, what do you do? Is there any other strategies you do to try and stand out in a day like that? Because, again, there must have been 50, 60 acts, you know, on the bill.
I mean, for the guys, it's just putting on a good show, you know, and they do a very good job of that. You know, all the guys have a very good live act. You know, it's an opportunity for them to network there, you know, that since they can connect with other artists, maybe, you know, set up some potential collabs in the future, you know. And for me, you know, I'm there connecting with artists, you know, label execs, the people putting on the show, just trying to build relationships to hopefully secure other opportunities in the future. So it's just a great networking opportunity in addition to getting exposure to fans, you know. So I'm definitely looking forward to being part of Rock the Bells.
Sure. So besides that time on stage, it's all about trying to get the word out, get new fans, you know, meet up with the artists, of course, you're building those relationships with. And, you know, maybe make some new collaborations, maybe someone you never met that, you know, now can be a new potential, you know, sparring partner on tours or, you know, trading information. That's what's so great about the indie world is we're very freely giving information. You know, back in the day with major labels, it was like competing sports teams. You know, the Raiders don't want the Chargers to know what they're doing. But, you know, with the indies, we always say that, you know, for the longest, it was the indies united just to stand out from the majors and that stranglehold they had on radio or retail or MTV or BT. But, you know, now it's just, it's pretty much a, you know, even if you know how Macklemore did it or how Tech N9NE did it, doesn't mean you can do it, but you can learn some of the techniques. And that's really what we look forward to, you know, with IES is sharing a lot of this knowledge, spreading a lot of ideas, you know, and you know, spurring those collaborations.
Well, we don't. I mean, I don't look at hip hop. I mean, it should be a competitive genre, but not in the sense that you can't share knowledge. You know, even if we shared all the knowledge in the world, you know, it's going to be very difficult for somebody to recreate another funk volume in a short amount of time. You know, and in addition to that, you know, music is not like another good. It's not like a refrigerator where somebody's going to buy one, you know, and not buy another refrigerator for another 5 years. You know, if you're a fan of Hopsin, you know, you can be a fan of, you know, whoever. You can be a fan of Crooked Eye. You could be a fan of Odd Future. You could be a fan, you know, so people aren't making those crucial decisions where they can only buy one record for a year. Maybe some people are, but very few people will, you know, are making those type of decisions of, oh, I'm only going to go to one show. You know, so we're very confident in what we do. You know, we're confident that we put out good music and we got good relationships with fans. So, you know, we don't look at the market as competitive like that. So we don't have no problem sharing information.
That's great. A lot of camaraderie in the indie world. And when we come back, we're going to talk about, of course, the big IES event coming up, all that exchange of information, people coming in from all over the country, all over the world to really, you know, collaborate and spur new ideas and success stories. Our guest tonight is Dame Ritter. He's the CEO of Funk Volume. We're talking about all sorts of great success stories with Hopsin, Dizzy Wright, and more to come from the label. We're coming right back with more on The Road to Hollywood.
Hey, how you doing? It's K. Robert Singer, IES, you know, representing. It was unbelievable. You know, a lot of information, a lot of great information. You know, you can't buy this stuff. So, you know, it was great. A lot of performances performed, had a lot of shows. It's pretty good.
Yeah, this is Flo Rocker, man. Flo Style Entertainment. IES Fest was the best fest that you're going to get, man. I mean, not to knock any of them other summits, man, but this is the place to be at, man. I mean, great legends came out, man, from all kind of guys. Chino XL, Spice One performed. You know, some of the biggest names in the industry. We had some of the biggest industry heads watching over all the new talent, and this is the place you want to go if you're trying to get on, man, or get your stuff out there. So come here to IES, man. Look at it. Check it out, man, on the internet. You know what I mean? This is the place to be, man. If you ain't here, you ain't gonna get there. Believe that.
How y'all doing today? My name is D Cross. I'm from Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm here to tell y'all should definitely come to the IES Awards.
This shit was crazy. We seen goddamn hip-hop legends. I mean, hip-hop legends, you know what I mean? From Alcoholics, you know what I mean? For the best, we had Tech N9NE on the Skype, Ice-T. It was real big. It was real crazy. You guys need to make sure you come out here next year. Call my man Jay. He gave me personal one-on-one interviews with major record labels, radio stations, TV shows. We had some amazing rock bands. If you think you got talent, it's where you need to be. Ain't nothing better than IES. D-Cross, Las Vegas, Nevada.
It's G-Knock, a.k.a. Gino Carnell, down here at the IES Power Summit. If you're not here, why you wasn't here? It's been popping. Nothing but legends, hit makers, beat makers, platinum artists, gold artists, artists from all over is making it happen. Don't be lazy. Get your grind on. Indie power will make it happen, can make it happen. Indie power is power. And you want power, don't be powerless. Stop sitting on the couch. Stop standing in the mirror. Get up out. Get your grind on. Get your hustle on. Do what you love to do. Get paid off of what you love to do. It's G-Knock. That's right. Indie Power. IES. Hook up with my man JW. Do it big. Go beyond. Peace.
Yeah, it's your boy Randy Boston checking in. Cold Crush Music Group. Flavor Collection. I'm out here at the IES event, the Indie Entertainment Summit Live 2012. Yo, if you wasn't here this year, you need to try to make it next year. There was a lot of experience here. The panels was great. I've been to several music conferences. They have old, washed up people that's not even relevant in the game, in the industry, come up here and talk like they know what's going on. We had real people here talking about real things. I learned a lot of stuff myself, how to grow as an artist, management, you know, learning how to perfect my craft, being a better artist, promoter, everything. So you missed out. Also saw some legends here, man. We was on the stage with Spice One. We had the Alcoholics here. You know, straight legends, man. And they was in here dropping game, letting artists know you can make it as an independent artist. So don't ever lose hope. You need to holler at my man J2. Pow.
My name is Lonnie Dangerous. I'm Just a Tip on iTunes and CD Baby. I'm here at IES. First time, greatest experience ever, and it's only the second day. Spice One came down, Tech N9NE Skyped, the Alcoholics were there. Violet Brown was here. It's the craziest thing ever. If you're on the outside of the music industry, the way to rub elbows with everyone in the inside of the industry is get down with IES. Big things. Deal with it.
Again, if you missed it last year, you got to be here. It is August 7th through the 11th. It is in L.A. It is IES. The website, again, is IESFest, F-E-S-T.com. And again, basically, there is so much knowledge, so much fast-moving changes and opportunities and technology and everything in the business these days. Reason why we put on IES is to bring all these people together, because like our guest tonight with Funk Volume, you know, people are making these independent moves. And it's great to bring everybody together, share a lot of these ideas and knowledge. It might spark ideas in you. It might be a connection that really opens up, you know, a whole new opportunity or avenue for you to do what you do. So whether you make music, you're a writer, producer, you manage artists, you run a label, you make films or videos, you're a DJ, whatever you do in the business, IES is designed to help you really elevate your game, make connections, of course, give you an opportunity to show the world what you got, showcase in front of people that can really help, you know, make moves for you. Again, our guest tonight has been Dame Ritter. He's the CEO of Funk Volume. Obviously, what you've seen in the business and who you've learned from, it's so important to be a student of the game. You know, these days, whatever, you know, ideas you find that works, whatever you know, you find on the internet or through other people that have done things. Why is it so important to be at an event like IES and be able to press the flesh and actually get a chance to create relationships in the industry?
Well, I mean, it's always important to attend events and to meet people, build relationships. You just, it's a very small industry. You know, and I find myself running into the same people over and over again. You know, so to start being visible and start, you know, being known amongst these, you know, these circles within the industry, you know, it's important. It's important for new opportunities that come about. You know, you never know, you know, who's going to have an opportunity for you.
Well, like you said, is it a very small world? Because as many people that want to get into it, there's a finite number of people that are really making it happen and right. have the perseverance. You know, a lot of people think it's an easy business or it's all about flash and cash, you know, and all of a sudden you get in and like you're talking about four to a room and you're in a sweaty van for 14 hours. And, you know, obviously playing in front of fans is a short payoff, but then you got to get back in the van and be lucky to grab some, you know, a cold burrito on the way to, you know, a whole nother setup. So it's certainly not glamorous all the time. You know, you see the award shows and everybody's in their, you know, party mode and clicking bottles. But, you know, behind the scenes, you got to love it. You know, the one thing everyone always says to me is, you know, you should do it because you love it. Even if you don't get paid, you gotta have a passion for it. Now, if you can turn this into a business or not, that's gravy. But if you don't love it for the love of, you know, really making it happen, you're probably in the wrong business.
Right.
I think you really see that, you know, when you come to an event like IES, is you're learning from other people's success stories, and you never know that one contact you make can be somebody that can open up, you know, and now all of a sudden you're on their tour in Canada and you're helping them out here, and, you know, maybe it's somebody you know that's, you know, you provide an inroad and you introduce them to Chang, and next thing you know, somebody's opening a door for you and somewhere else. So, you know, right. a lot of the veterans, you know, we work with the industry, they've been doing this for 20, 30, 40 years. So those are the kind of people that are not faking. You know what I mean? They've dedicated their lives to this, and there's not too many of these people that just pick up the phone, you know, to everybody that calls.
Right.
And that's one of the great things about coming to IES is you're able to meet people that, by and large, you can get their phone number and call them all day long. But a busy guy like you, you just can't take every call from anyone that's right. that's calling in. So tell us about that.
Well, you know, the way that we've built relationships, you know, again, I'm gonna go back to the fans. Like, you know, we have the opportunity to be at these events to start, you know, meeting people in person. You know, but again, it all started with our fan base to get us here. And now it's like, okay, now let's build relationships with people. Cause you know, coming from, if you start from a bottom up approach as opposed to a top down, you know, a lot of people, our fans know us, but a lot of people don't realize, you know, what we're doing, you know, so I still have to introduce Funk Volume to a lot of people and lift the hood up so people can see everything that's going on, and they'll be impressed once they've gotten introduced to it, but a lot of people still don't know. You know, so it's very important for me to start building these relationships, letting people know about Funk Volume. You know, and if I have the opportunity to be at these events, you know, it's a perfect opportunity to do that.
Well, we certainly look forward to having you part of IES. We've got over 100, you know, real movers and shakers in the industry, people that are running those types of careers of the Tech Nines and Macklemores and, you know, Mac Millers and so many of these great success stories. We're going to be celebrating, you know, the independent success. We're going to be, you know, certainly opening up the ideas of new collaborations, new technology, new things that are going to really help us, you know, all move forward. So like I say, no matter what side of business you're on, it's a small price to pay to really be able to make these connections, learn from people that are doing this at a really, really high level. And, you know, more importantly, show what you have to offer. You know, one of the things we do, we have an event called Deal Link where they get a couple minutes with each of the decision makers. We line them up in kind of a speed dating or, you know, elevator pitch fashion where you learn to succinctly present what you have. Sometimes you don't have 10 minutes and the ability to hear, listen to my music. No, Tell me in 30 seconds or 60 seconds what it is. Why should I want to know you? Why should I accept your calls? Why should I want to set up a meeting? Or why should I ever, you know, want to do business with you? Right. And a lot of times it's very, very succinct. So we thank you so much, Dame, for coming down. We're
my
big
pleasure.
Fans of Funk Volume, Hopsin, Dizzy Wright, Swizz, and the whole family. We can't wait to see you rock the bells this summer and do it big. So all you listeners, please come out to IES, join. You're going to meet this man. You're going to learn from the greats out there. And we can't wait to see you next week on the Road to Hollywood. More coming up.